that despite having colleagues who are in hospitals, students whose heads have been broken, I can't help but feel absurdly happy. It's not just because flowers are blooming, but because there is now something all of us can fight for again. And I find that every time I get depressed about being in a university, the fact that students don't attend my classes, nobody reads my articles, now at least there's a reason to believe in the university again, to feel happy that we all, JNU, DU, Jadavpur University, Hyderabad University, FTIR, we all have something to fight about. So maybe the university, with all these boring articles that we write, all these incomprehensible things that we read, and all these boring lectures that we give, maybe this is a spurs worth defending. So I'm just happy that, you know, there's some meaning to what we do after all. Otherwise, they wouldn't be so busy attacking us. Just to give you a sense of, I got some figures from how the universities were under attack in the Third Reich. And it's quite interesting that, of course, I mean, if you look at the educational program of the Nazis, obviously school education was a big issue, changes in history textbooks, the promotion of folklore as a subject, extolling sort of, you know, greater German history, etc. And the parallels to that are quite visible in India. But even in terms of, and they also had a youth league, you know, all of the things that we see today with stormtroopers, the ABVP functioning as stormtroopers. But what's also interesting is the attack on higher education. And you see across the world, in fact, wherever there are authoritarian regimes trying to muscle their way in, one of the first sites is higher education. In Turkey, 1,000 teachers have been sacked or suspended because they signed a letter condemning the attack on the Kurdish people, and for this peace letter they were all sacked. As I was saying, in Germany, 15%, between 32 and 34, in fact in 2 years, 15% of the entire university staff was sacked, of which 56% were sacked for political or racial reasons, and 35% for racial reasons. So among the people who are targeted are people who have taken political stands, people who have an objection to the regime. And one of the interesting things is how, in a way, it sort of points to the irrelevance of universities, but also when you had the Nuremberg trials, the doctors, the judges, all of them were tried for their role supporting mass crimes, in supporting the Holocaust. University teachers were not perhaps tried in the same way, although you have well-known people like the philosopher Martin Heidegger, who said that National Socialism was a breath of fresh air. At some level, the university fell in line. So you see that same pattern of a large number of people becoming silent, because unfortunately, as teachers, the sixth pay commission is something that we find it hard to give up, or the promise of the seventh pay commission. Our salaries, our leave, our next trips abroad, all of these are important to us, patronage from the university. So there is a large mass which is silent. Students are often the only ones who are protesting, because in this class structure of the university, they are like the proletariat, they have nothing to lose. Although students, again, because of the way that they have to pass exams, are something that the authorities count on, that eventually students will have to go back to studying, they'll have to stop protesting, they'll have to give up. And so they know that because, again, this is a transient population, they can break this population. So this is a struggle not just against the authorities, but against our own colleagues, against the silence and the forgetfulness and the patronage relationships that our own colleagues enjoy. And this is something that we need to constantly remind ourselves, that the university is something that we all need to defend, not just a few people. The second thing I want to talk about is the question of patriotism. And you know, I don't think that it's now, we all know that the AVVP sort of, I mean, to say that the AVVP is cloaking itself in the mantle of nationalism is simply untrue. If anybody, I don't believe that anybody in this country is anti-national, but if anybody was to be called anti-national, it would be the AVVP, because clearly it would be the RSS, because they do not believe in the constitution, they believe in a Hindu Rashtra. This is not something which is allowed by the constitution, it is not what the freedom struggle meant for. The usual historical version is that the Muslim League was responsible for partition. We forget how much the RSS was responsible for partition, how much the Hindu Mahasabha was responsible for partition, how much they are now trying to create civil war within this country. So if anybody is anti-national, if anybody doesn't believe in the Tiranga, if anybody doesn't believe in the constitution, it is the RSS, it is not the rest of us. As for being anti-national, I want to ask how anybody, I mean, people in this country are protesting in all sorts of ways for the idea of freedom, for the idea of azadi from exploitation. If there are women Naxalite cadres who are marching 8 or 9 hours in the forest, knowing that if they are caught by the security forces, they will be raped. I met a woman who has since surrendered, who, when she was in the party, had to give up her child because it was not easy to carry a child around. So a mother to give up her child and to do this for something that she believes in, I don't see how somebody like that can be called anti-national. You may disagree with their idea of the nation, you may disagree with what they're fighting for, you may disagree with any number of things, but to call them anti-national because they believe in a different idea of the nation, they believe in a nation that is free from exploitation, free from injustice, just betrays your own ignorance. And that goes for all the different people who are struggling in this country, whatever they are struggling for. Third, I want to point to the commonality of struggles for the basic rule of law. You know, at some level now, all of us realize what it means to be an Adivasi in Bastar when the police will not register your FIR, when they register false FIRs, when they lie through their teeth about what has happened. So for instance, when we see that what happened in Ramjust is described as a clash between left-winger groups and students of Ramjust College, when it was clearly a one-sided attack by the ABVP on students and teachers of Delhi University, you realize how much this law that we are fighting for, the rule of law itself, is such an object of struggle, how we need to struggle not just you know, in a larger sense, but struggle about the law, against the law, using the law. And just to give you an example from Bastar, in 2011, when the police forces burnt three villages, Tadmetla, Timapuram and Morpalli, they burnt 300 houses, three people were killed, three women were raped, three old people died of starvation, and all of this was registered by the police in their FIRs as the Naxalites burnt the villages. You know, the police had nothing to do with it. Eventually, the Supreme Court ordered a CBI inquiry. The CBI, instead of filing their own FIRs, simply took over the police FIRs. And then for years, they kept investigating the police FIRs about the Naxalites burning the villages. So when we kept asking them to register fresh FIRs, say that, you know, which actually reflected the truth, people had given testimonies of what happened, it took, you know, they sort of gave something in the Supreme Court about how, in fact, yes, we went there, we also found prima facie evidence of rape and murder, etc. And the Supreme Court asked them, well, did this happen along with that incident or later or not? So it's a complicated story, but it's taken 5 years for the CBI to register charge sheets against the SPOs, some of the SPOs who carried out the burning, not against Kaluri, who masterminded the whole attack. And when it comes to rape, they obviously, if there's, you know, 300 security forces attack your village, burn the houses, rape you, there is gang rape, it's impossible to identify the perpetrator. So because the women cannot identify who raped them, they say nothing can be done because they could not identify the rapist. they take the sari of one of the victims who, this is one of the two saris that she has. The attack happened in March 2011. The sari was taken for forensic examination in January 2012, 9 months later. And again, this has been washed several times. And then in that final report, they write, no forensic evidence was found in the sari to establish that rape had occurred. So from, you know, wherever you go for years, this, you know, if you look at our entire legal struggle in Bastar, in a way, it's just been to establish FIRs, leave alone the prosecution and the, you know, arrest, etc., that will follow after that. And you see precisely this kind of thing happening even in a place like Delhi University, where you would think that it would be possible for students who are, you know, in the heart of Delhi, etc., to register an FIR. The police is refusing to register an FIR that actually has any resemblance to what happened. It's refusing to accept people's complaints. The ABVP is flooding the police with their own complaints about what happened. So it's important to march. It's important because they are using law as a weapon against all of us. It's important to also use the weapon of the law back against them, to fight about the law, to struggle with the law as much as we struggle with everything else. So I'm just going to stop at that, and hopefully the other speakers will take on. Actually, it's just a poem that I like. It's a poem from South Africa by Ingrid Jonker. And it's because so much of the struggle is being taken forward by students that I just wanted to read this poem in a sense. It's called The Child Is Not Dead. The child is not dead. The child lifts his fist against his mother, who shouts Africa, shouts the breath of freedom and the world in the locations of the cordoned heart. The child lifts his fist against his father in the march of the generations, who shouts Africa, shout the breath of righteousness and blood in the streets of his embattled pride. The child is not dead, not at Langa, nor at Nyanga, not at Orlando, nor at Sharpeville. These were all the scenes of major massacres during the apartheid period. The child is not dead, not at Langa, nor at Nyanga, nor at Orlando, nor at Sharpeville, nor at the police station at Philippi, where he lies with a bullet through his brain. The child is the dark shadow of the soldiers, on guard with rifles, Saracens, and Bidens. The child is present at all assemblies and lawgivings. The child peers through the windows of houses and into the hearts of mothers. This child who just wanted to play in the sun at Nyanga is everywhere. The child grown to a man treks through all Africa. The child grown into a giant journeys through the whole world without a pass.